Can you hear me? It's on?
Right.
Yes, thank you, Samantak. And in fact, it's really for me a very moving experience to talk about William and my friendship with William, which, as you said, goes back half a century, nearly, to 1970, in fact, to the time when William and I, and indeed the lady who later became William's wife, Elizabeth Stevenson, as she then was, were all studying English together at Oxford. And at that time, certainly I had no idea, and William himself really had no idea, that he would ever make the cultivation of Bengali and translations from Bengali the most important thing that he was going to do through his life. Not, I should say at the outset, the only thing. He has certain hats which he hasn't worn for a long time and which nobody knows about. It might come as a surprise to maybe all of you to know that he is, for instance, a fully trained psychiatric nurse, and he worked for some years in a psychiatric hospital. Because obviously you cannot make a living by translating Bengali poetry. So sometime in his youth, you know, before he got the job at SOAS, at the School of Oriental and African Studies, he was actually working at a psychiatric hospital. But that apart, in the sort of nearer to his line of activity for which we know him, he's also, let us never forget, a very fine original English poet. He's not just a translator. He has several volumes of poetry, which might have been better known if they had not been overshadowed by his work as a translator. Anyway, as I was saying, we were reading English literature together, and at that point, I don't think William had any particular predilection towards the Bengali language. He had been once to India, as so many sort of backpacking young Europeans do, on a kind of general touristic sort of tour around India before going back to England to start his time at the university. In fact, what I think directed his attention towards Bengal and Bengali was the Bangladesh War in 1971, the Bangladesh Liberation Movement. We were undergraduates at that time in Oxford, and the Bangladesh War had a great impact on the youth of Britain, and particularly in the universities at that time. There were big demonstrations in favor of Bangladesh, of what was to become Bangladesh, in favor of the movement. Then the students contributed money to set up scholarships to bring students out from what was to become Bangladesh. And I think William was emotionally involved, to some extent also actively involved in that movement. Later on, actually, his political views changed somewhat. He was, in fact, one of my few friends I can think of, and he has remained a friend for all his other sterling virtues and his patience on his side, despite the fact that he was, and I believe is still, quite a strong supporter of the Iraq War from the British side. But anyway, that was in the future. I think the Bangladesh Wars first set him thinking about Bengal and Bengali, as I said. But it came as a surprise to me when, after completing my course and returning to India, I got letters from him saying that he planned to take up the study of Bengali in a serious way and was joining the course at SOAS. After completing that course, he came to Kolkata. I mean, he very rightly realized that he needed some kind of exposure to the social environment of Bengal. And he came, in fact, it was a great pleasure for me that for months he stayed at our house in Kolkata, talking to my parents, whom he addressed to the end of their days as Baba and Ma. In fact, the copy of his selected poems that we have at home is not inscribed to me, it's inscribed to my parents in Bengali as Baba Make, William. See, still, it's one of the biggest treasures in my personal library. And he has been, just a few seconds indulgence in a pure vein of personal sentiment. He has been present at some very important moments of my life and a family life, like my own wedding and my mother's death. But and that was a time when he just used to go around Kolkata simply so that he could meet and talk to people, see, invariably traveling by public transport. And he would go and have long sort of conversational sessions with my sister. And anyway, he went back, and that was when he had first, really, I think, decided that he wanted to translate Rabindranath. And after going back, when he was in fact earning his living first as a schoolmaster, then as a psychiatric nurse, which was a better living actually, he got a higher salary there. He went that he took up translating, and then he brought over his portfolio of the first drafts of his translations for another long stay in Kolkata. When he went over, worked over those translations, he discussed them with various people here. Then, of course, he was back when the book was actually published on a sort of kind of protracted launch and publicity trip. And that really was quite an overwhelming experience. There was briefly a kind of William Radice weave, you may see. He was much lionized, which maybe it embarrassed him, maybe threw him slightly off balance. But he sort of weathered the storm. I deliberately put it that way, and it did not, I think, let the lionizing stand in the way of the serious course of development that he still needed to do. He followed it up with his translation of the short stories. And then, although he has always said that I am basically a creative writer, I'm a poet, I'm not a scholar, invariably, I mean, he's a scholar, of course, and his PhD, as you probably many of you know, is on Michael Madhusudan Dutta, not on Rabindranath. But he has done very serious scholarly, particularly textual work on Rabindranath, the upshot of which is his own very solid edition of translations from Rabindranath's Gitanjali, but also comparing Rabindranath's final versions with Yeats's versions. So, and then, of course, he has worked on various aspects of Rabindranath's life and work, and this book, which is just being presented to the world, is the outcome of that. So I think I've talked long enough about this personal vein.
I think if Rabindranath could see this event, he would have been extremely happy, because he really was India's first truly and consciously international author, figure, poet, and it would have pleased him that an Englishman and a German, both of whom are honorary Bengalis, should take it upon themselves to talk about his oeuvre, Rabindranath's oeuvre, and responses to it. But Martinda, what I want to ask you is, what made you do this? What made you decide to collect William's writings and, yes, make this book?
Well, it's working. As most of us know, in 2013, William had a bad accident, and since then he is not working. For the years before that, from 2010 to 2013, he was going up and down three continents, Asia, Europe, and America, to give lectures on Rabindranath Tagore in honor of the 150th birth anniversary of Tagore, 100 years of Gitanjali, 100 years of the Nobel Prize. And then that happened. He was run over and by a lorry, and he, after that, went into retirement. And I knew that he had done all this work in these previous 3 years, giving lectures, and astonishingly, he did not give the same lecture in each place. He did not have 4 or 5 lectures which he gave in Washington or in London or in Kuala Lumpur, because obviously these audiences would have been quite different, but he had one lecture for each place. And that was a mass of lectures, some only notes, some really worked out, some also published in journals. And I knew that he had a massive collection of such notes, and I asked him to give it to me. He sent me a stick with several hundred pages, and I selected these lectures and articles which are in this book as a book, as a sort of harvest of what he has last thought on Rabindranath Tagore. And it is being named Gitanjali Reborn because a lot of his articles and lectures are referring to this book, Rabindranath Tagore's new translation of the Bengali Gitanjali, discussing especially what Yeats, as Sukanta mentioned, has done with the original English translations of Rabindranath. William Radice thinks that Yeats has really overstepped his duties, has done far too much of on the manuscript than really should have been his brief, and he tried to rectify that by first of all showing all the unnecessary interferences of Yeats, as well as giving his own full translation of Gitanjali in this book. And I feel, Sukanta, I don't know whether you agree with me, this book, Gitanjali translation, is yet not really being critically assessed and respected and evaluated. And this kind of critical assessment is still waiting to come.
Yes, I would agree. I would indeed agree. Because, I mean, this is the, William has, you know, laid the foundation for what should, can be and should be a sort of major exercise in critical inquiry, which I think he himself would have carried out if it had not been for this unfortunate accident. But in fact, it's not simply for one person to carry out. This is something that should be a kind of general critical pursuit of the scholarly world as such, and not restricted only to the poems of the English Gitanjali, but to all Rabindranath's subsequent translations also. See, in this book, William has laid down the foundation for that, which a long time ago, there was some pioneering work that done in that direction by Professor, the late Professor Shamal Kumar Sarkar of Bishwabharati, and another professor who's also no longer with us, the late Professor Bikash Chakraborty, also of Bishwabharati. Shamal Babu's writings have in fact come out in a very valuable collection, which was published 2 years ago and has passed,
passed by completely unnoticed.
It's sunk without trace.
And Bikash does writings also. And Bikash does writings as well.
Yeah, but Bikash Babu's was still confined to the journals,
right,
whereas Shamal Babu's have been collected in the book. But after those two pioneering scholars, the next piece of sustained work in this direction is William Radice's. Okay, I should say the first sustained exercise in this direction, to the best of my knowledge. I don't know whether some other, forgotten scholar's work has also sunk without trace, but certainly that's what I know of. And there is a great deal of work waiting to be done in that direction. And this is now somewhat easier to do since the preparation of the comprehensive Tagore website, Vichitra, from Jadavpur University, which in fact allows you to access the full text of every Tagore manuscript, both at Vishwabharati, the Rabindra Bhavan, and or at Harvard, where so many of Tagore's important English manuscripts are. And it's the Harvard manuscripts which William has used here. Well, now anybody sitting in any corner of the world can do that, and we hope that this very valuable work that William began, and which sadly he will probably not be able to continue, will be taken up by others as it deserves to be.
Right, Sukanta, can I ask you to continue what you were saying about William's work?
It's an interesting story how this book came about. First of all, I should say, Gitanjali Reborn, the new book that we are talking about, is explaining what he tried to do in this one. He's giving really a summary of the critical assessment he is trying to do in this book, which came out in 2011. And in 2010, he was in Shantiniketan for 3 months as a visiting professor in order to finish up this book, which he had started in London and which he had to finish then with a deadline. And right in the middle of doing this in Shantiniketan, he broke his wrist, his right wrist. A terrible thing. He couldn't do the computer anymore. He couldn't write on the computer anymore. He was incapacitated in many different ways because he had to have plaster on his hand. And now we see the character and the strength of this man, William Radice. He carried on dictating whatever he had to translate for his assistant in London, who was being sent these things, then sent back after rewriting them, and then he corrected, and it was finally, through a real tour de force, being published at the right time in 2011. I was there then, we helped him as much as we could, but the actual work, obviously, he had to do himself. And in the evenings, I went to visit him, and he came up with all these discoveries he had during the day at Rabindra Bhavan's library, looking at the at Yeats' manuscript and at the Tagore manuscript, and then revolving in his mind by talking to me about it, what his attitude and his critical assessment of it would be.
Right. I'll just read out a little section from this, and you'll know why. Kolkata, Shantiniketan, Hyderabad, Mumbai, Delhi, and Ahmedabad, Marbach, Copenhagen, Lund, Zagreb, and Rijeka, London, Dartington, Cambridge, and Birmingham, Stockholm, Leiden, Salamanca, Barcelona, and Valladolid, Washington, and Chicago, Kuala Lumpur, and Singapore. Who would have thought when I started learning Bengali in 1972 that Bengali, and particularly Rabindranath Tagore, would eventually take me all over the world? And it is precisely this sort of spread that William was responsible for in many ways after the publication in 1985 in England of the selected poems of Rabindranath with the Rothenstein bust on its cover. And then about a decade later in India, it is still the most widely consulted book and remains a bestseller for Penguin even today. And in this book, Gitanjali Reborn, I don't want you to get the idea that it is only about Gitanjali or only about translation. He talks about a lot of things and a lot of aspects of Rabindranath, including his empathy for others. And there's a wonderful chapter called What I Have Learned from Rabindranath, which sort of What I Have Learned from Tagore, which brings out so many aspects, not only of Rabindranath, but also of Radice. And for me, a Bengali, somebody who has always read Rabindranath's Bangla in the original, it is always interesting to have the kind of perspective that William brings to it. Somebody who came to Bangla late, somebody to whom it always, in a very important respect, remained a foreign language, but through which he could discover many new things. And it is this tripartite engagement, as it were, Rabindranath, Yeats, another great poet, and William, who, as Sukanta has pointed out, liked to identify himself as a poet first in many ways, that leads to certain critical insights which we would not get because there are so many things we just take for granted in Rabindranath. Now I want to ask Martinda something. Martinda has done something similar for Rabindranath in the German language through his translations, and friends of mine who know German have told me that they have, as it were, rediscovered Rabindranath because they read his German translations and they read his book, wonderful book, Rabindranath Tagore in Germany and others, and then sort of go back to the poems. So do you think this is part of what we get from somebody like William?
Well, it is really just as it is that I was encouraged by William Radice's translation of Rabindranath's poems to do it myself from Bengali into German. When we look at translations which had happened before 1985, before this translation happened, we have, for example, one book which I looked at, 101 Poems of Rabindranath Tagore by Humayun Kabir.
He was the editor.
He edited it.
And he did a few of the translations also.
He did a few.
And he, other rather renowned people of Bengal did the translations. But just the surface meaning of it. It was not really a poem. It was not in verse. It was not rhymed. It was not in any kind of rhythm. It was just the surface meaning of the poem, and there it was. Now, William, for the first time, as I can see, has translated a poem of Bengali into a poem in English, trying to show that Rabindranath Tagore can be translated into a poem in English. It needs a lot of courage. He has received a lot of criticism, and he has done it, and he has been successful. But there is one but, and that is he has used a crutch. I particularly recall it this way. He has made notes at the end about each and every poem. In order to explain what he had done in the poem, those meanings which could not be carried over in the English, he has explained. It's a kind of line-to-line commentary and explanation of what is happening in his poetic translation. And this I have made my method as well, that it's quite impossible to translate Rabindranath's poem into a German poem, and that is it. It's a different language, it's a different culture, it's a different religion, it's a different age, and how can you really expect that poem to be carried into German just like that? So I did use notes, just like William did, line-to-line commentary, and it was published in Germany, and there are 5 volumes of my poetry translation there, right there in the market, and it is due to him, and one of the books I dedicated to him, that I could do this, and I had the courage to do this. This is the story of our friendship and of my debt to William Radice.
Yeah. Can I pick up from there? Because you spoke about line-to-line translation, word-to-word translation, and William has been meticulous in looking at every single word and every single line and looking at the nuances which might be missed in English. And indeed, in his analysis of Rabindranath's own translations in Gitanjali, he does exactly the same thing. He goes back to the original Bangla, then he looks at the English, then he looks at the English poem as a whole. But that's not what I want to talk about. The very, very interesting point that he makes about the manuscript of Gitanjali, which had 83 poems, and the actual English Gitanjali as it was published, is that there was a certain kind of integrity not only to the poems themselves, but to the arrangement of poems, which was then taken apart. The number was increased by about 20. And they were arranged in a completely different order. And William feels that this harmed the integrity of the larger text. Now, Sukanta, as somebody who has been the general, the series editor for the Oxford Tagore translations, how do you respond to this business when it comes to poems, of the integrity of the individual poem, the translated individual poem, and the integrity of the whole? And I'd want you to respond to that as well. But Sukanta, could you talk about this?
Well, actually, I'm not sure I can return an answer, and certainly not in my capacity of the editor of Bichitra, because in Bichitra can be just sort of providing all the material.
No, Bichitra, na. I mean, we'll say Oxford Tagore.
Oh, well, by Oxford Tagore. Okay.
Your Oxford Tagore.
Well, the point is, you see, that in all these, in William's book, then in Christian Martin's German translations, Understand, which unfortunately I'm incapable of appreciating, on my own translations, or the translations, which I edited. There were other people involved also for the Oxford Tagore translations. These were all selected volumes. Okay, we were not translating as William did later on in his later Penguin volume, which had seen. We were not translating any full collection of poems by Rabindranath in its integrity. So in the translations, it was necessarily being lost. And the point is that this was done by Rabindranath himself, because his English Gitanjali, of course, was not it didn't correspond at all to his Bangla Gitanjali. It took material from several volumes and left out much material from the Bengali Gitanjali. And also, I believe the manuscript evidence is fluid, because I've also looked physically at this Harvard manuscript. What is described in the Harvard catalog as a notebook. In fact, many of those blue pages are actually separate pages. Maybe they originally formed part of a notebook, and they were accompanied by letters from Rabindranath to Rothenstein. Those letters have now been separated and separately catalogued in Harvard's Houghton Library. And in the other manuscripts also, it's difficult to tell from the manuscripts, insofar as I've looked at them. I've not looked at them properly. But insofar, from a preliminary glance, it's difficult to tell whether Rabindranath had any structure in mind, or whether we are retrospectively reading a structure into the English Gitanjali as it was finally published. See, I think that has to remain an open question in our present state of knowledge. Maybe somebody can, and somebody should, I hope it will happen before long, that somebody will look at the whole series of manuscripts which lay out these translations, and consider not only the text of the individual pieces, but the way they come together.
Yes. Martin.
Well, one thing which William did in this book, Gitanjali, and which he explains in Gitanjali Reborn, is his translation of songs, which I think is quite unique. One may agree with it or not, but he has really thought it through and thought it out and then decided to do it. He translated the songs of Rabindranath as they are sung, with all the repetitions and the refrain being repeated again and again. And this is how he translated the text of the songs.
Martin, can I just read out what he says about it? William writes, "I found that by preserving the poem's song structure, it took on a new kind of rhythmic life. For many years, I didn't know what to do with Tagore's songs. Only gradually, as I came to understand the structure of the songs when they are sung, their repeated refrains and other repeated lines, and a basic division into four parts, only then did I realize that a translation could, by preserving those features, instantly indicate that this is a song text and not just a poem to be read on the page." Sorry, go on.
Yeah, this is what I wanted to say. So I was to bring the ball back to Sukantada. I see there are three people who have really tried hard to translate Rabindranath's poems into English, and that is William, yourself, and your teammates, and Ketaki Kwashi Dyson, doing real poetry, trying to do real poetry. Do you see yourself as a follower, William Radice, or as a corrector of him, as an improver of William's translations, or how do you see the changes that are happening in your translation? And I realize that in the poetry translation book of Oxford University Press, you also translate a few of William's poems, which he has chosen, you have chosen again, and done quite a bit different of a different translation. Can you react to this? I found this very interesting and intriguing.
Yeah, actually, of course, I did something else where I was really laying my head on the block. I've translated some poems which Rabindranath had translated himself. Teammates had done that. William and I have also had a lot of arguments about translating Rabindranath. Although in very different ways, we have both tried to retain something of a poetic structure, those ways were indeed very different. We have had long, sometimes quite acrimonious arguments about it, and it says a great deal for William's patience, much more than my own, that our friendship to this day remains as strong and as sincere as it was when we set out, in fact stronger over all these years. But basically, you see, I'll just say a couple of sentences about what I was trying to do, and then what William said he was doing. I was trying to translate, keep a stanzaic structure as close as possible, given the very different mechanics of English, to Rabindranath's own stanzaic structure. Whereas William was reworking it in much newer ways. And that is where I think his own identity as an original English poet came in. And because I was interacting with him, seeing him, I had a sort of ringside view. I'm not saying they did it in consultation with me. That again, we argued and very more often than not differed when there was any exchange. But I could see what he was doing, and he was spending a huge amount of time in deciding exactly the right stanzaic form in English for a particular Bengali poem. Not the equivalent of the Bengali in English. Not that it would look the same way on the page, which maybe later on I tried to do more in the Oxford Tagore translations. But he was thinking of an independently valid English poetic structure, which should at the same time retain Rabindranath's, the impact of Rabindranath. So it is an immensely difficult job. And, okay, he has been criticized sometimes for failing to do it, but I think, we should really appreciate how often he has succeeded, the extent to which he has succeeded in this apparently impossible challenge.
I'm tempted to ask another question. You see, you mentioned that William is first and foremost a poet himself. He has done 10 volumes of poetry, after all. And that this quality of him being a poet has obviously contributed to him being a translator of poetry, an able translator of poetry. Now, both you and I are not poets. And once I had an argument with Kateki Koshari Dyson, who is a poet, that only a poet can translate poetry of Rabindranath Tagore. And then I was the next in the panel to say something, and I kept mum. And she said, "Why are you not talking?" And I said, "Well, I'm not a poet. I have to give the microphone to others." I think you were on the same panel at that time.
I think that was, in fact, at the Calcutta Literary Meet about 2 or 3 years ago. Yes, that's right.
And then she asked me, "Have you never written poems?" I said, "Yes, as a young man, as a student, I wrote a few poems, and I never got them printed. "Oh," she said, "then you are a failed poet. So you are a poet." Now, I think you may not be even be a failed poet, and still you are translating poetry.
No, but Sukanta is a poet and a published poet, because I have, when he was very, very young, in the 100...
Please let me rake up the mistakes of my youth. But actually, I will take up on that, which is that William at least set out, and I think to this day he would say, sometimes at least, that his work in translating from Bengali is a part, which has come to become an increasingly bigger part, of his total identity as a poet and his total corpus as a poet. And there, not only the translations of Tagore, but what he set out with, and what in fact he has done remarkably well, is translations from Madhusudan, which have also now been published. See, I think we did interact. He was translating Madhusudan when he was bringing out when he was writing the poems that occupied his first two volumes, in the third volume. And his translation of Madhusudan was in the nature of a particular kind of poetical experiment that he thought would help him to write his own poetry. So it's as though somehow, especially I think to people in India, the perspectives have altered. We think of William Radice primarily as a translator. In England, now, to be perfectly frank, he's not a very celebrated poet or translator in England. I mean, it's not as though England is ringing with his name. But of course, he is known, he's recognized. But there, again, his primary identity would be that of an original poet who has also done translations from this language that most of his readers are not really very interested in. Okay, so we're looking at the thing from the opposite end of the telescope, which in fact may be the right end of the telescope. Okay, if somebody writes a life of William, as I hope somebody will, then let's see what they end up by stressing.
And I also think that we Bengalis do William a disservice, and this came forcefully to me because I did criticize a lot of the poems in selected poems. I don't think I wrote about it, but I certainly spoke about it. And then I happened to go to Delhi, and there I met a lot of people who were either not Bengalis and therefore had no access to Bangla at all, or were the children of Bengalis who'd been settled there for a very long time, who could sort of speak the language haltingly as it were, but couldn't read and write it. And they were full of praise for his translations. So I think what has happened to William, to William's translations, is a kind of, you know, history repeating itself. Rabindranath would not have become a pan-Indian figure if he had not translated his own works into English and then won the Nobel Prize. He really became a truly pan-Indian figure, especially amongst the not sort of elite intellectuals after the Nobel Prize and the accolades in the West. And William's work has done something similar. People in Delhi, people in Chennai and other places are going back to Rabindranath. And it is very interesting, just a few days ago, a young person of Bengali origin who's been born and brought up in Mysore told me that she started to learn Bangla at the ripe old age of 23 because she wants to read Rabindranath. And she came to Rabindranath through translations, including Sukanta Das and Williams. But I think I've belabored the point long enough. If there are any questions from the audience,
I don't want to hold you back from, but there are just two or three small points I wanted to add, which will take about a minute each. One is, taking up from that passage you read about his globe-trotting, we have to give William his due, not only as a translator, but as, you know, after Rabindranath himself, really the biggest ambassador for Rabindranath's work that the world has seen. You know, it is because of those Penguin translations that the Anglophone world, at least, and therefore the whole globe now, has been reminded that Rabindranath exists. See, he has played an immense role that way in the reception, the global reception of Rabindranath. This also we must bear in mind. See? The second thing is, I just wanted to cite to you, where there's an advanced stage of one of our long arguments, which was being carried out by letter. People actually wrote letters and posted them in those days. See, and he wrote back, I think I remember those sentences verbatim. He said, "You bilingual Bengalis will never be satisfied with any translation of Tagore. You know both languages too bloody well."
So, if there are any bilingual Bengalis or monolingual other language speakers who would like to ask questions, we'll take questions now. Questions, comments? This one, the gentleman in front. Okay, you go ahead and we'll come to you in a minute, sir.
Hello, Martin Jethu. Hello, Sukanta Jethu. Hello, Samantak Da. I'm Rohini. I've had the privilege, the honor to perform a number of times with William Jethu because my father, Debashish, is a very good friend of his. And we have cut an album together. It's called The Dust and the Sunlight, which is exclusively on Gitanjali songs. And in that album, William Jethu had recited some of Rabindranath's translations and also some of his translations of Rabindranath's songs. And then I remembered what Martin Jethu just pointed out. He asked my father to send him some of the songs that he wished to translate. One of them was Aro Aghat Shoibe Amar, because he wanted to see that how many times did he repeat the lines when he sang it, and he wanted to recite it exactly that way. Like, it starts like, Aro aghat shoibe amaro, aro aghat, aro kothin shure bina hridoye tare jhongkaro. Abar it comes back to aro aghat shoibe amaro, three times. And he translated it the same way, I will endure more blows, I will endure them, I will endure more blows. And it goes on the same way as it as we sing the song. So he had done it for a number of songs like that. So I just thought I'll add this experience of mine. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that illustrates exactly what Sukanta Da and Martin Da were saying about the song-like quality of the poems. The gentleman in ma'am, the gentleman in front would like to ask a question.
My concern is that Rabindranath, he has written about human and the nature so beautifully and brought out things so nicely. Now, how those things can percolate in the future life of the children who are coming up, new generation, unless it is made given in the school, some such thing, etc. So the poetry should not remain in books. It should be lived. It should be experienced in our day-to-day life. So how that should take place, this is for that how and what we can do, this is what my concern is.
You want to go first?
Yeah. Well, I have said many times when I was reading my German translations of Rabindranath that the most important service one can do to Rabindranath Tagore is translating him. Translating him, translating him. More poems, there are masses of poems, as we all know, and to publish them, to distribute them, and make them available to the general public, in schools, in universities, in India, abroad. Translation is the main business of helping Rabindranath to regain his status as a world poet, as a member of world literature. This is my very simple answer.
Actually, I don't think I have very much to add to what you said, Martin. I mean, this is really a different problem. I mean, we are talking about the dissemination of Tagore rather than the practical dissemination, rather than the actual translation which you were focusing on.
But can I say some? True. We all agree. But you know, this experience I had about a year and a half ago, when Jadavpur University received a call from the Prime Minister's office, because our Prime Minister would be going to Korea, and they said that there's a poem that Rabindranath has written on Korea, and could you find the original manuscript for it? And we searched high and we searched low, and we couldn't find it because that's, you know,
we did find it. Finally, Omlan Dasgupta did manage to locate the text. Was it a manuscript?
No. I managed to locate the text.
Sorry.
But there's no manuscript because it is probably something that he either dictated to someone. But the interesting thing is that every Korean child knows this short four-line poem by Rabindranath because it's part of the primer that they read in school. I think the equivalent would be class 2 or class 3. So he's known throughout Korea. And Martin Da was telling me several years ago of a radio program that he did about Rabindranath, including his translations, which was enormously popular. So I agree entirely that you have to bring Rabindranath to people, you know, maybe, you know, write rock operas using his lyrics, do something, set him to other kinds of tunes, all of which are being done. It's only if you read his writings, not just his poetry, but his other writings. I mean, now with the rise of Theresa May and Donald Trump and so on and so forth, I keep going back to nationalism and rereading what Rabindranath had to say about nationalism. So, and through his writings, maybe then you will actually go out into nature and appreciate life. Sorry. Any other? Yes. One, two, three.
Sir, this is not a request, this is not a question, but a request to all three of you. Could you hear something about Tagore's translation, little pieces, maybe in German also? Could we hear
Tagore translations? Hear Tagore translations? I don't know whether there's time. Let's have the two other questions. Okay, we have time. So let's have the other questions and then I'm sure.
Yes, many times there has been accusations, not by me, but a lot of persons, that Gitanjali was actually based somewhat on the Upanishads and Rabindranath just put his words. But others have pointed out that if the Upanishads indeed are so sacrosanct, it was Rabindranath uniquely who did that. No other person came close to that. So my question is, what was William Radice's comments on that? That of the uniqueness and originality, quote unquote, of Rabindranath while writing the Gitanjali. And number two is that Rabindranath in his manuscripts, we have seen that he made a lot of figures and cut them, and those also carried a lot of meanings. So what was Radice's views on that? Because that could be a gateway to Rabindranath's mind while writing the poems of Gitanjali. These two questions I want.
Well, I don't know that William had views on either of these issues. First of all, the more basic critical question, if Rabindranath's poems either in the Gitanjali or elsewhere, drawn the Upanishads, that hardly impairs his originality. Okay, all poets draw on earlier material, their success of the poetry comes out that way. So you don't say that a poet is a good poet simply because what he's writing has absolutely no precedent in any earlier work. Then you'd have to dismiss, practically any great poet anywhere in the world. So that's not, a valid critical criterion to start with. That apart, I don't know whether William ever discussed this with Martin. He certainly never discussed this with me. And I don't know that William was particularly familiar with the Upanishads, frankly. And what was the other question? The doodles. Though actually, there again, I don't know that William had any views on the subject. And generally speaking, the general view, which to me seems a valid view, I have in fact studied the doodles, I've written about them, is that the doodles did not have, with very, very few exceptions, they had no direct relationship with the material on the page. They don't really carry much meaning. They might carry some kind of different counterpointing line taking off in a different direction. But they're not an extension of the meaning, within quotes, of the poem itself. Hardly ever.
But did he talk about the Upanishads and so on with you, Martinda?
Well, it occurs to me that his introduction of the selected poems of Rabindranath Tagore uses as a guideline a line of the Upanishads. He moves, he does not move, and so on, just as a guideline to sort of structure his introduction. So obviously he has the Upanishads in his mind, but that does not mean that he has imitated or been especially inspired by them. That, I think, would carry things too far.
Also, I don't think it is necessary for a translator to know the sources of a poet's inspiration. If you can know the language in which the poem exists, and you're translating it into another language, that's, I think, all that matters. I don't know whether you'd agree. Yeah. And there's a question right next to you. Right next to you. Yeah.
I think I'm probably the only student of William Radice present here today. So it was my privilege to work with William as a PhD scholar at SOAS. And I just thought I'd say something about William the person that I saw as a student. And he was a remarkably open person as a scholar. And I think that is something that I still cherish, because we can be very closed in the academic world. And he was somebody who was extremely regular, something that I tried to emulate and fail. So I would send him a draft chapter at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he would send me a reply at 6 o'clock in the morning saying, I've received your chapter, and could you please meet me on such and such date? And he rarely canceled his appointments. Again, something that I failed to do myself. And somebody who was so, so very open with what I had to say. And if I disagreed with him, he just went with my view, even if he knew better and I didn't. And that for me was so remarkable in a scholar. And it made the 4 years that I worked with him, such a pleasure that I still look back on those days. And I often think when I supervise my students today of what William's supervision meant for me. And if I can just put in even a little bit of that into my supervisions with my students, I think I would have probably done a good deal of good. So that's what I wanted to say about William, the person and the scholar.
Thank you. Martinda wants to respond to that.
Well, as a response, I would like to just tell a little episode of my own life and of my own relation with William. You see, he had learned German very well and translated, in fact, one book of mine of short stories into English, which then came out in India in Rupa Company. And he visited Germany quite frequently, for the last time in 2010 when we had a Tagore seminar in German language in Germany, in Marbach, and that his German was very dear to him. His own daughter now lives in Munich, as you may know. And he had visited me in my hometown Boppard near Koblenz, not far from Frankfurt, several times and got to know my mother quite well. He even came to visit her when I was not there, when I was here in India. And he once told me, say in 2005 or something like that, that when your mother dies, she was then above 90, please let me know immediately, I would like to attend her burial. He was there in England. I came in 2007 when my mother died. I was in Kalimpong. I came back to Germany in order to attend the burial, and I informed him. And in the morning of that day, there he was, coming from Newcastle, flying to London, London to Frankfurt, coming by train to Boppard, my hometown, to attend the burial of my mother. Even now I feel very moved that such genuine emotion that he had several years ago then would fructify when the promise he has made really is relevant. So I think many of us have such kind of moments with William when he showed his true character, the genuineness, the truthfulness, the words of his character, I think.
Yeah. And his openness, which I think is important. I didn't know William at all, but on one occasion in Shantiniketan, I got into a sort of argument with him about one of his translations. And he's a very tall man, you know. So I was looking up, literally looking up at him and saying, I can't, because he was standing around having tea and talking. And I said, I can't really agree with you. And he said, well, of course, you know, you may not agree, but he'd never once said, but I'm right. He said, so he allowed me that space for disagreement, which I think Sukanta also mentions in his interactions with William and his correspondence with him. So are there any questions? And if there aren't, then we will come back to the young gentleman's request to read out a couple of translations. I don't know. No further questions? Then, yeah, ma'am, here. In front, please. Here. This way. Yeah. To your right. Thank you.
Hello. Actually, it's nothing question, just a memory I want to share. In 2011, that was in Bombay, Martin Da was present and William Da was also present. And there was some question answers. There, by the by, Radice sir, he said that the translation of Where the Mind Is Without Fear, that towards the end, it is into that heaven of freedom, let my country away. But he said that the Bengali is much better. Nij hoste nirdoy aghat kori prito bharoter sei sorge koro jagorito. That nij hoste nirdoy aghat kori prito, it is missing in the English. And we were really so touched that not being a Bengalian, he is finding out the actual word that is missing. And then we had to tell the Maharashtrian and Gujarati audience how the implication. And I think Martinda was very much present over there.
He's a meticulous reader. He's a meticulous reader of text. Right. And there's a long section on the use of commas in the English of Rabindranath. How many commas were used and what they mean in terms of pauses. And how they, you know, Rabindranath was trying to, I mean, there are many more commas in the manuscript than there are in the printed version or vice versa, and how the absence or the presence of a comma makes a change to how you receive a poem. I think he was always very alive to the poem as something we hear even as we read it, which shines through in his translations, and which also shines through, I think, in Sukantada's translations, not just of Rabindranath, but of his magnificent Sukumar Rai translations as well, the sound, not just the sense.
But about Rabindranath's manuscripts, about the commas, actually, there's a general point which is worth making in this connection, which is that if you look at the across the range of his manuscripts, you find that the total number of manuscripts with his English poems or translations called the world, all his English writings, in fact, prose also, it is disproportionately high. There are far fewer manuscripts of most of his Bengali works. Many of them were lost, but even then, the thing is, he was much more, at ease with writing in Bengali. I think that's the conclusion we have to come to. He didn't feel the need to, keep rewriting and revising all the time and pay attention. I mean, the punctuation of his Bengali manuscripts, those in his own handwriting, is either non-existent or very casual. He wasn't bothered about it. But when he was writing in English, he took much more care. He worked and reworked his translations or his original writings also. There are, over a dozen drafts of many of his prose writings, one piece is taken apart and joined up pieces of other things to make three pieces. It's very complicated. He was obviously in a much more, particular about getting the English absolutely right. He was not as supremely at ease as he was with the Bengali.
So I think we've pretty much run out of time. So sorry, we couldn't accede to your request, and thank you for being a marvelous audience. Thank you. Thank you, Martinda. Thank you, Sukanta.
Thank you.
And this book is available, I think, outside, in the bookshop.
On behalf of Tata Steel Kolkata Literary Meet in association with Victoria Memorial Hall, I would like to thank Mr. Supriyo Chaudhuri, Mr. Martin Kämpchen, and Mr. Samantak for being a part of Radice's Tagore.